Streams and rivers play a large role in shaping the Earth's landscape. They function as drain pipes for rainwater from the land to the oceans. All of the waterways are part of larger systems known as watersheds.
Well, I think to define a watershed, you should think about the shape of the land and go to the high points and imagine that when it rains here, that water's going to flow downhill and continue downhill and join up with other water, and as it continues, it's usually in a creek or a lake, and then we call the watershed for that creek that land that water just came from.
A watershed system consists of several parts that are interconnected and contribute to the function of streams and rivers. Uplands are the higher, well-drained land areas of the watershed. As water travels from the high areas to the low areas, it flows over and through different land uses such as forests, grasslands, crops, retail shops, and residential areas. Not only water moves through the uplands, but also sediment and pollutants.
The floodplain is, to describe it, it's more like a bathtub that a river runs through or a creek runs through, and it's the overflow to that creek. So from bank to bank is your river bed. Then you have the floodplain, which can be anywhere from 500 feet to half a mile in some places wide, and that is the overflow for the creek when it floods, slows down the flood waters. If it's heavily cropped with trees, then that improves the floodplain's function, but if it's an agricultural field, it loses a lot of its ability to slow down stormwater and treat pollutants as it comes down the floodway.
Some of the things that riparian areas do is, one, that they're a mecca for life. They're known to be some of the most biodiverse areas on the planet. So, for example, ranging from everything from insects to vegetation to mammals, you name it. They just tend to be a place where there's a lot of different organisms all sharing in the same place, yet occupying different ecological niches. So they all do their own thing. They all have their own lifestyle, life history. Riparian areas or riparian zones also are excellent for filtering polluted water.
When people think about the channel, they tend to think just about where we've got water at the moment that they're out there, and they think that's the stream. And in reality, the stream channel goes all the way up the banks. And that's the way the stream functions. It has to be able to transport the amount of water that comes in common sorts of high water events. And the channel adjusts to those frequent runoff events and being able to carry that much water. And so we need to be thinking about the stream channel extending all the way up to those banks. And then in a really high water event, the floodplain isn't part of the channel, but it's part of the carrying capacity of that stream in terms of transporting that water.
A stable stream system in this environment would mean that we've got quite a bit of meandering occurring, that the stream continues to move one direction or the other almost all the time, but overall the absolute linear stream length may not change that much.
What tends to happen is you have some erosion at the outside of a bend, some deposition at the inside of a bend, and that pattern moves both laterally and downstream. And so there's a natural progression where the channel migrates through that floodplain. And over time, you know, in geologic time, it's been all across the floodplain. If you take a look at a stream around through this part of the world, you'll often see that there'll be areas that are shallow water, rocks that are exposed, water's running through there fast, and we think of those as riffle areas. And it's important that as the water's moving through there fast and you're exposed to lots of air, you're adding oxygen to the stream. You'll get different sorts of aquatic insects and aquatic and fish and other amphibians making use of those areas. And you move on downstream and you're likely to get into still some faster moving water, but more shallow and not quite as turbulent, and that we would talk about as a run. And from there you'll move into deeper water of a pool. And pool is slower moving water and it's deeper, and again it's different habitat than you find in the riffle. You'll find different fish using the pools than use the runs or use the riffles. And so all those different aspects of the habitat are important. And too often when we've altered streams, we've ended up making them all be sort of like a run type of a habitat, and we don't have that variation, and we don't have the same variety of aquatic habitat, we don't have the same variety of aquatic insects or fish living in the stream.
You know, you could think of the land as a sponge, and you know, the soil we can understand is picking up and holding moisture, but even the rock underneath is, when you have like limestone kind of rock, the rock itself has little pores that hold water, and it's released pretty slowly, but it needs to be recharged continually from above because it's also continually flowing out somewhere. I mean, most of this is coming on back out of the cave, but other inputs of that groundwater are continuing to stay in the ground, in the aquifer, and then when you drill a well and pump it up, you're getting that very same water. Soon we'll see a spring, and often people think, oh, spring water, that means it's been underground for decades, you know, and it's very pure. Well, you can't make that assumption, because here, that spring water has been underground for only 3 days at most, and it could have in it any impurities, pollution that came from the land. Because the sinkholes are really just nature's drain pipes. You know, there's cracks in the bottom that allow the water to flow very freely through. So it's not getting cleaned or filtered. It's just, and that cave is only about 100 feet below ground, connected by these cracks and sinkholes. So it's very, even though it seems like a world away when you're in the cave is connected very closely through the water flow here in these karst areas.
In contemporary systems or urban environments, we expect we see a lot more surface runoff. And in fact, that surface runoff, increased runoff, turns into increased flow with higher velocities, which can lead to more erosion. And of course, that water finds its way to larger stream channels, which tend to also incise more or cut out the channel deeper. It'll also result in greater bank erosion and so on.
The size and shape of the watershed can change in terms of how fast the water is being delivered to the stream, and if it's all coming very fast, we're getting a difference in that energy and the stream power associated with that. Other ways that we have altered the slope of the stream over the course of time, doing things like thinking we're improving the stream by straightening it, and that greatly increases the slope and it increases the rate the water is moving and how much it erodes.
There's a misconception, I think, that if we see a lot more suspended sediment here, that it's because of something we're doing bad in the landscape. But that's not necessarily the case when you consider the fact that if suspended sediment is higher here, it could also be due to the fact that there's been a lot of in-channel erosion occurring, and that larger particles of sediment become very tiny, tiny particles by the time they get here. And we'll kind of erroneously, I think, kind of think, well, it's from the urban environment. That's not necessarily the case.
Sediment is real important. If you think about, if you turn over some of the rocks in the stream, hopefully you'd find some different sorts of insects and other things living in different cracks and spaces between that sediment. But we also affect the stability of the stream by how much sediment is supplied to the stream. If you have a lot of ground within the watershed that has been left bare, cleared for some particular reason, we'll get a lot of erosion from that spot, and then it ends up in the stream. It can bury the habitat of the fauna, the aquatic critters that live here, and that's a critical factor, obviously. But it also can change, if we deposit a lot of sediment in the channel, then our floods come along and they're growing out of channel when they might have stayed in otherwise, and we end up with damage out on the floodplains because we've altered the system in that fashion.
We've felt for a long time that the waters in the city of Columbia are polluted with sediment. We don't know that for sure, and in fact, some of my research is showing that that's a lot of eroded larger particles from higher up in the watershed that are just kind of making their way downstream. The key is to figure out how much of it is from natural processes and how much of it is from human-induced processes. And I think that when it comes to sediment, that we might be a little surprised to find out that this is not all human-caused, that there's a lot of natural stuff taking place.
When we think about the vegetation, we need to think about everything through the whole watershed. When we settled this area and we changed from pasture or from prairie to pasture and row crop, that was a change in the vegetation, and it probably caused a change in the amount of sediment moving off that landscape, increasing the sediment that the stream had to move along. And as we change from pasture and row crop to an urban setting, we're doing the same thing. We're changing that vegetation, we're changing the water balance within the uplands, exposing more soil at times, but changing all the components of the system.
Streams and rivers have a great influence on the land around us. The various parts of a watershed all play important roles in the life of a stream. They affect how we develop our communities and live our lives. As residents of a watershed, the more we can do to better understand our constantly changing environment, the better off our streams will be for future generations.